Welcome to the Renaissance and welcome to this edition of It Is Written versus Truth for Negroes, a reply part 2. Remember, in short, as has long been known, in his physical organization, the typical West Coast Negro, whether living in Africa or living in America, is as near the anthropoid apes as any of the savage races of mankind, perhaps the nearest. R.W. Sheffield, 1907, and this is from the book The Negro, A Menace to American Civilization, published 1907. And from P.A. Brown, in applying these rules, we soon found that the hair of the head of the Choctaw and some other nations of American Indians is cylindrical, that the hair of the white man is oval, and that the wool of the Negro is eccentrically elliptical or flat. And this is from the book The Classification of Mankind by the Hair and Wool of Their Heads, with an answer to Dr. Pritchard's assertion that the covering of the head of the Negro is hair, properly so termed, and not wool. And this was published in 1850. And this should help you understand that those telling you that the Negroes, also called African Americans today, are now Native Americans. Remember, the Negroes have woolly hair. The Native Americans have straight hair. And never forget that the Negroes were also enslaved in Europe. They were actually used to build Europe. So now that they are done with America, they are now trying to change their identity. Always remember to ask yourself, how can somebody with woolly hair be the same as somebody with straight hair? That's impossible. It doesn't matter how you look at it. But moving on to what we're talking about today, the Negro as an emotional being. Do you remember abolitionists, Quakers, and the American Civil Rights Movement? Do you also remember that some Negroes opposed emancipation and denounced the abolitionists? Do you think the Negroes opposed to emancipation or freedom loved slavery and the slave trade, or just that they loved their masters and their own individual conditions, so their masters may have easily gotten them to be doing what they are doing? Remember, all you need to get the Negro to fight against his brother is to elevate him to a house Negro and use him against the field Negroes. Do you remember the Civil Rights Movement? If you do, then you will certainly remember Malcolm X and Martin Luther King Jr. Have you ever wondered why the slave master celebrates Martin Luther King Jr. but not Malcolm X, even when they both fought for the same civil rights? And if you have never, do you know why? It's simply because Martin Luther King Jr. followed the path the slave master wanted him to follow, while Malcolm X refused to do that. That's all. But did you, however, notice that something happened to both of them? Negroes in the diaspora. When the so-called African Americans were hired to protest for one Nigeria and to deny the genocide and ethnic cleansing against indigenous groups, especially Christians, in Nigeria, have you wondered who hired them and who provided the money they were paid with? Do you still doubt that they will use African American soldiers in mass killings they planned for the area? Why do you think the slave master is always able to use the Negroes against themselves time and time again? In any case, today we shall be responding to comments we received from our previous videos. Remember, these response videos are actually for us to learn more about how they carried out their atrocities against the Negroes and how they are doing the same till today. It's not necessarily for the minds of the descendants of the slave hunters or their slave master accomplices to change. Never. That can never change. It is an article of faith for them. They believe that the Negroes do not deserve to exist as humans at all. So here is a comment from someone that goes by the name Mr. Himself Alone. He claims to be a so-called African American, but he is certainly a Fulani. Or even if he happens to be a so-called African American, may have gone to a DNA test or something and it showed that he had Fulani blood. And so in this first comment, he says, Glover formed the nucleus of what is today Nigeria's army and police. He started the force with 10 Hausa runaway slaves on 1st June 1863. The group was known as Glover Hausas or Glover's 40 Thieves. Now we ask you, why would somebody that has just 10 Hausas be tagged Glover's 40 Thieves? instead of Glover's 10 Thieves. But please remember that we had addressed this in the past to debunk that it was never an army the way they claim it was formed. The Nigerian army was originally a slave-hunting terror group used to capture and export Negroes as slaves. It became Nigerian Army in 1863. They just renamed it, but they now looked for a story to tell as how it became Nigerian Army. And a quick look at the website of the Nigerian Army. Remember, they have removed this the moment people started asking them questions about how the Nigerian Army could have been older than Nigeria. So it says the same thing, that founding of the Nigerian Army. The history of the Nigerian Army dates to 1863, when Lieutenant Glover of the Royal Navy selected 18 indigens from the northern part of the country and organized them into a local force known as the Glover Hausas. The small force was used by Glover as governor of Lagos to mount punitive expedition in the Lagos hinterland and to protect British trade routes around Lagos. Now you notice how Europeans came into the land that is not theirs, took some people that claimed to be sensible humans and using them against supposedly their own people. But leaving that apart for now, you notice that he said 10. These ones are saying 18. And above all, they are all supposedly Hausas. Hausa is just one of the numerous ethnic groups in the north. And above all, they are not Negroes, but they are Negroid. He goes on to say, it performed both police and military duties for the Lagos colonial government. It later became Lagos Constabulary. On incorporation into the West Africa Frontier Force in 1901, which is also a lie, it became Lagos Battalion. In addition to this force, the British government included the Royal Niger Company Constabulary Force in northern Nigeria in 1886 and the Oil Rivers Irregular in 1891. In 1889, Lord Lugard had formed the incipient body of what was to be known in 1890 as the West Africa Frontier Force in Jeba, northern Nigeria. The new unit expanded by absorbing the northern Nigeria-based elements of the Royal Niger Company Constabulary. But we want to ask you this question. If the Nigerian Army was already existing in 1863, why did the British colonial thug called Frederick Lugard form another army called West African Frontier Force? It was the army he was using to fight against the slave hunters. So this shows you clearly that the army was not what they claim it is. It's a jihadist army for slave hunting. It is never a national army. So that's what they are hiding in telling you that it could have been this and that, and these people came and formed another West African Frontier Force. We can also go ahead to show you where this same army they are talking about attacked the West African Frontier Force. But like we told you, the slave master is a subtle beast, and his slave hunting accomplices, they lack humanity and common sense. So in everything they say, all you need to follow is attention to details. You will see that they are just liars. Let us take this a bit further by referencing the Nigeria Handbook containing statistical and general information respecting the colony and protectorate compiled by A.C. Bonds of the Chief Secretary's Office, Lagos, 4th issue, and this was published in 1922. Here we see that in 1906, Lagos and southern Nigeria were amalgamated and designated the Colony and Protectorate of Southern Nigeria, the old Colony and Protectorate of Lagos becoming the Western Province, while the remainder of the country was divided into the Central and Eastern Provinces. So we challenge you to ask this Mr. himself alone, how could 8 Hausas or 18 Hausas or 10 or whatever number they chose, taken from northern Nigeria to Lagos that was not part of Nigeria in 1863, become Nigerian Army? So we see clearly that taking people from northern Nigeria to a place outside Nigeria couldn't have been the origin of the Nigerian Army. They are lying. Let us also reference Life of Sir John Holly Glover by Lady Glover, and this was published in 1897. Here we see that after Mr. Glover's journey to Busa, he returned by river to Raba, shooting the rapids in a canoe, and found that Dr. Beke and the remainder of the expedition had been unable to get any assistance during the time he had been away surveying. Remember, Dr. Beke is the man after who the Igbos call all white people Beke. That's the man here. We wanted to read this part so that you understand the context. And it goes further to say, remaining here some further time without any prospect of relief, he at last volunteered to go alone and bring the relief himself. He was given horses by a chief, which we know certainly wouldn't have been a Negro chief. Remember, the horses were at that time owned by their slave hunting accomplices, and they were working together. And he goes further to say, and went overland to Lagos, being the first European who ever made the down journey, not the up one, be it remembered. It was on his way to Lagos that he passed Ibadan, where he made the acquaintance of the missionary and his wife, Mr. and Mrs. Hindres. Here he was taken ill with dysentery, and Mr. Hindres acted as nurse till he recovered. He then went to Lagos, and from Lagos got shipped to Sierra Leone. Now, look at the story they are telling us about bringing Hausas to Lagos. And he goes further to say, at Sierra Leone, he came into contact with certain Africans who wished to return to their part of the country. These men bore the name of Hausas, a name evidently of German origin, and in many respects, these Hausas resembled German soldiers. They would not venture to go back again by themselves because of the risk of capture and slavery. There seemed to be, for them, no chance of getting a passage up the river. When Lieutenant Glover offered to take these poor fellows with his party, they at once gladly accepted it. One named Harry Maxwell became much attached to him and was faithful in his service for many years. Our interest is to show you that their claim that he brought 10 people or 18 people from the northern part of Nigeria to Lagos was a lie. You see that it's happening in Sierra Leone, not even in northern Nigeria. So that you see that these people are just liars. That's all they know. Everything about them is a lie. And going further down here, it says, with the Hausas, Mr. Glover returned to Lagos. While waiting the completion of his preparations at Lagos to return overland to the camp on the Niger, he worked hard surveying the lagoons, and the occupation undoubtedly caused the fever which attacked him with great severity. Some exciting scenes took place at Lagos when it became known that many of the natives of the Hausa country had joined the returning party. These men who were in slavery tried to escape from their masters. The Hausas would give notice that on such a night they would attempt to run away, and on trying to escape they were often pursued and captured. And further down it says, it then became known that the owners of the run slaves had formed a party to dispute his passage by force. Mr. Glover was, however, quite prepared to run the risk on the appointed day. The opponents of his passage did indeed assemble with a view to barring his path, but apparently thought they might get the worst of it if they fought, so let him go. In due time, he arrived at Abeokuta, where the native authorities are by no means disposed to give him a free passage. Considerable excitement occurred here, as a slave amongst his party was recognized and claimed by Madame Tinubu, who was a very influential person in this town. But on his giving this sharp-sighted lady a large roll of cloth, she abandoned her claim. Those are not really our interest here. Our interest is for you to see what really transpired. This book was written by Glover's wife. Please never forget, we had addressed this issue in the past. What the descendants of the slave hunters do is, after a while, they will come back with exactly the same thing they have been saying. Remember, the slave master knows how to lie, but he remains consistent with that lie. He continues telling it, no matter how ludicrous it appears, he continues to repeat it. That's all the slave master does. And from the book we referenced earlier, it tells us that the native population of Nigeria, which is estimated at about 16.25 million, is divided into a large number of tribes speaking different languages and possessing different characteristics. In the northern provinces, the Hausa race, which is chiefly Mohammedan, is the most important numerically. The Hausa is wholly black, but not Negroid in type. Remember, you keep hearing them claiming that Fulanis were also sold. How many times have you ever heard Hausas were also sold? And he goes further to say, his known history, though never brilliant, has been persistent. Many times conquered, he has nevertheless continued to preserve a clearly defined political individuality. He has always been merchant, peasant, soldier, and artisan. His language is the lingua franca of the Sudan and the only language of tropical Africa which has been reduced to writing by the natives themselves, modified Arabic characters being used. Large numbers of Hausas are serving in the Nigeria regiment and in the Cameroons and East Africa have justified the high opinions held of their soldierly qualities. Remember, it is coded for their slave hunting accomplices to always use them. That's why there are a lot of them in the Nigerian army and even in the Cameroonian army. They are used for the wars you see going on. No Hausa has ever ruled Nigeria. They are just used as the army. The Fulanis may be few, but they control thousands of Hausas. Let us also reference The Dual Mandate in British Tropical Africa by Frederick Lugard, and this was published in 1922. Here we see that it is essential to realize that tropical Africa is inhabited by races which differ as widely from each other as do the nations of Europe, and that some of the principal racial types present even greater divergence than those of Europe and parts of Asia. Broadly speaking, the colored population of tropical Africa divides itself into the races of Asiatic origin which have penetrated the continent from the northeast and east with their Negroid descendants who chiefly occupy the northern tropical zone, and the Negro tribes which inhabit the greater part of the remainder. The immigrant races, generally called Hamites, are supposed to have invaded northeast Africa probably a good deal more than 4000 or 5000 BC. So you see that those that are killing the Negroes today are actually the Hamites and they are immigrants to the area. And it goes further to say, there was a Semitic invasion some 2000 years later, but its elements have entirely disappeared, though it has left indelible traces on the language and racial characteristics of Abyssinia. The principal Hamite or Hamitic Negroid tribes in East Africa are the Abyssinians, the Somalis, the Galas, the Maasai, the Wahima, and the Nandi. In West Africa, the Fulani, supposed to be descended from the Berbers, all have been modified to a greater or less degree by admixture with Negro blood, which has produced racial types differing from each other and widely different from the Negro type. Now remember that the Fulanis are Hamites, they are not Negroes, and also bear in mind that the target of the slave master there is the Negroes. He has an inborn hatred for the Negro race. If he could wipe them out today, that's what he would do, and that's what he is trying to do. It doesn't matter whether you believe us or not, you're gonna see it happen. They vary in their mental and physical characteristics according to the amount of Negro blood in their veins, which has shown itself extremely potent in assimilating alien strains to its own type. Perhaps the most distinctive external characteristics, much more reliable than that of color, by which the degree of Negro blood may be gauged is the hair growth and the head and face, varying from the woolly head and smooth face of the pure Negro to the straight hair and bearded face of the Asiatic. So when you hear the likes of Kremo Ahau or the likes of Dane Calloway telling you that being African has nothing to do with the woolly hair, just know that they are lying. They have been contracted to say that because the slave master believes the Negro does not reason himself. He has to believe whatever he is told. But then, our main interest in citing this material is where it says, the Negroes and the Negroids who approximate most closely in race type to them consist of innumerable tribes. In northern Nigeria alone, there are said to be about 380 which have each their own special traits, but they share in varying degrees the general characteristics of the Negro. So our challenge to you now is, he claims that Glover brought 18 Hausas from northern Nigeria, the same thing you saw in the website of the Nigerian army, although they have removed it the moment they were asked questions around it. Like we told you, they know they are liars. They can't defend anything. All they know is when you catch them, they will either fight you and kill you. The same way you see even on YouTube or Facebook, they will be censoring comments from Biafrans and Amazonians. That's the same game they play. They know they are liars, so they can't actually defend their lies. So our question to Mr. himself alone now is, how could they select only Hausas from a place that had over 380 ethnicities, different races and different groups? So you can very easily see that they are just lying. The Hausa has been spoken of at that time is even totally different from the Hausa race we see today. You can see the narrative from Glover's wife is different from what we're seeing here, in the sense that there is no way you could have just taken Hausas from a place that had 380 different racial groups and then you could just pick all of them from only one group. And you tell us it is Nigerian Army. It was how it started. The Nigerian Army was originally a terror group used to capture and export humans as slaves. In 1863, they just renamed that terror group and it became Nigerian Army. And that is one thing they are hiding. So when you see them driving, this is what it is, this is what it is. Just bear in mind that they are lying. So all you need to do is to find time and study the materials yourself. Stop allowing the slave master lie to you every now and then you believe him. That's why he continues doing it. And another comment from this same user called Mr. Himself Alone says, you have poor reading comprehension. It says they could not obtain European goods without slaves, meaning the Fulahs sold people. You keep acting like people could not be traded for things. It does not matter who in Africa sold people. The fact is they were sold or traded. Never did I deny that Fulani captured and sold other African slaves. They did. What you want your viewers to believe is that Igbo or what you call Negroes never did. Even though Olaudah Equiano, who was Igbo, said his people sold slaves. So please bear in mind that the person writing this claims to have been a so-called African-American, but like we told you, the slave master knows how to penetrate into a Negro community and act as an enemy within, the same way they did during the slave trade. That was how they conducted slave raids as well. They come and live in within that community, identify where their strongholds are, and then on the night they will strike, they will come and kill all those that offer any type of resistance and cut away the rest of the community as slaves. But this comment is his response to this portion of the historical records when we read them, and it says most of the towns were well fortified considering the force likely to be brought against them. The reason was that the Fulans, that's the Fulanese, were a warlike people capable of placing 16,000 men in the field and prone to hostilities against their neighbors since they could not obtain European goods without slaves, nor slaves without making war. However, only the young and strong were taken. The old and feeble, to avoid trouble, had their throats cut. But they excused themselves for this barbarity by declaring that the people whom they thus raided, robbed and murdered never prayed to God. So he has been looking for a way to stop us from reading this portion. Remember, like we told you, they make sure that every truth is suppressed and they'll feed the next generation with their lies. And it goes further to say, and that as the European factories would sell guns, powder, and cloth for no other articles except black men and women, the people whom the travelers tried to persuade into more peaceful pursuits had no alternative. Moreover, did not the book, the Quran, enjoin on the faithful to make war against the infidel? So his problem here is because the material is saying they killed the old people or cut their throats. That's those they couldn't take as slaves. They had their throats cut, which they justified at that time. They said it was better to kill them than to allow them starve, since they have taken all their children away. But to better understand who they are and how they behave, you see that a year ago, this same person made this comment. Do you repeatedly read over the same thing for the benefit of new listeners or just to keep old listeners pissed off at the Fulani? You see that he's all here to defend the Fulani, and that's how the slave master uses the descendants of the slave hunters. He will say it's a cell. They will join him to say it's also a cell. So if they were to hold a symposium on slavery or the slave trade now, they will bring him to come and present a paper saying that it was still where his own people sold their siblings. So that way the Negro is further demonized and made to look like a fool. So that's why they always try to get people that look like Negroes to be used against Negroes. The same way you saw them bring so-called African Americans who have no ideas what is going on in southern Nigeria, where Christians have been killed, to come and protest and say it's propaganda and it's a lie. So that's the game. You see, they have done that to deceive everyone and to prevent people from knowing that that's what they are doing there. Remember, they work together.